right, good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming out today. I appreciate it. I think this is our second time to be in Mobile.
For today's program, we want to thank Teva Neuroscience and Sanofi-Genzyme for providing us the funding to do today's program, and I want everybody to thank them as well, and for you all to know that we cannot possibly do these kinds of programs without the funding that we receive from the pharmaceutical industry. Thank you.
With no further ado, that's all I have. I know y'all are going to enjoy this program.
Thank you very much. Let's get started with Dr. Steingo. I don't need a mic.
Good morning, welcome. The program that I'm going to present to you today is a little different. It's the first time we've actually done it in this format. As you heard before, much of the stuff we've done in the past is recorded. It's on YouTube, on the Learning Channel. So you can see many of the prior programs that I've done with Stuart. Stuart happens to reside about 12 miles from me and visits my office periodically. And so I've done many programs with him going back over the years, and many of those programs are on YouTube, you can find them. And we decided to do something a little different today, although there's some overlap with prior programs, but what we're doing that's a little different today is Stuart asked me to talk a little bit about the evolution of MS. So when you go to these programs that you've been to multiple times, you hear people talking about MS medications frequently. You've heard them talk about the drugs for years. And so we didn't want to spend a lot of time talking about the medications that we currently have. You've heard a lot about them. I will summarize them briefly. I'm going to talk about some of the future drugs. So part of evolution is where did we come from and where are we going to? And that's a little bit of what I'm going to talk about. Some of the slides I've put up here are different from a usual format that I use in that they're quite detailed. Often if I see a detailed slide, it kind of is a lot to read. But the reason I left it like that is so that you have time later, when the program's over, you can look on YouTube and you'll be able to read some details about some of the things I'm saying instead of just giving you some sketchy bullet points. I wanted to leave some detail, and some of it's from the MS Society, you'll see that. So the first thing I wanted to talk about was what I call the land of MS. And this is something that I thought about, is that if you have MS, there's a whole bunch of things to think about. When you go and see a neurologist, there's not just one item. There could be a bunch of things we're talking about. How's the MS diagnosed? What type of MS do I have? How do you treat the MS? How do you treat relapses? What are the drugs that you use to actually modify your disease? And then I put into this land, and you can picture this land any way you like. It could be a beautiful island, or it could be an isolated island. We're trying to make an island flourishing and growing, and as time has gone by, we can do more and more on this island. But the symptom tower is a symptom tower because the symptoms of MS are so many. We could spend all day talking about just the management of the symptoms. There's many symptoms. And then MS research. This is another tower, the tower building of research. I'll talk to you a little bit about research today in our program as well. And then support. Support means social support. It means friends. It means family. It means groups like this. The importance of support. And then finally, very important section is self-help. And what you see here is that the land of MS is a team effort. If it's not a team, it doesn't help. I'm the coach in my office. I consider myself to be the coach. And I tell everyone else what to do. And hopefully everyone else is going to follow our plan. I'm not claiming to be Nick Saban. I guess that's the guy to talk about over here, or Don Shula. But I'm the coach of my patients, and I'm going to discuss with them a plan. How are we going to go forward? Treat the symptoms. Talk about the importance of social aspects, all those important aspects. So that's in the land of MS. And so what I wanted to now talk to you a little bit about is the history of MS. And they've looked at records of people from the Middle Ages, if you can imagine that, and said, this person sounds like they had MS, and it's probably been around for hundreds of years. But it's really about 150 years ago, in 1868, that a French neurologist called Charcot described MS. And he had a young patient that had severe tremors and neurologic disease, and eventually was able to study her brain. And for the first time, when he examined the brain, found little plaques. So 150 years later, we still talk about plaques and lesions in the brain. They were first discovered, described 150 years ago. MS was first described in the US in 1878. So think about how long ago 1878 is, like almost 140 years ago. And for all those years, 1868, 1878, we had no treatment for this disease until the first drug came about in 1993. So think about that, how many years we went by that we didn't have treatments for this condition. And finally, in the last 23 years or so, we finally have some effective treatments. But we knew years ago, over 100 years ago, that MS was a disease that was more common in women than men. and it could produce many different symptoms. But we didn't understand at that time that it could affect the immune system. So it wasn't until we developed new tools, later at the end of the 18th century, the 19th century, new tools were discovered that we could examine the brain. And for the first time, we started to learn about what MS was. And we knew that it was an inflammatory disease. So it's very important that this inflammation that occurs in MS. It was only later that we learned that MS was an immune disease or an autoimmune disease, and the immune reaction causes inflammation to form in the brain. And then later we learned about myelin, and importantly about the cells that make myelin, which we call oligodendrocytes. This is a slide I put up over here. This would be a slide of someone with an MS lesion. And so if you look in the center of that, that's a blood vessel. So that red oval center is a blood vessel, and around it you see hundreds or thousands of purple little dots. And that's that's inflammation around the blood vessel. And this is what they found in the past, and today that's still the hallmark of MS, an inflammatory disease where we see inflammation around a blood vessel. That led to some of the early theories about MS. So there were early theories about MS that maybe MS is a disease of blood vessels, that there are some toxins or poisons coming into the system causing this inflammation. So early on, we found they identified bacteria and viruses, and they thought MS was a disease that was due to blood vessels. In the 1930s, they developed an experimental model of MS. And you can see it summarized there. It's called EAE. And we still use that same model today. Even this week, there's a major MS meeting going on in Europe. This week in London, a major MS meeting. And there's still some studies where they're studying this model of MS, this experimental model. So it was discovered many years ago, and it's still important for us with MS. In 1946, Sylvia Lowry founded the MS Foundation, which of course was a huge step forward, raising money for MS, developing grants so we could do MS research. And then started finally coming about studies on the immune system. And now you've heard about it. We talk about T cells and B cells and what's the importance of them. And we're still learning about these. We still don't know these. Guidelines were drawn to diagnose MS. It was very hard to diagnose MS. A major step forward in diagnosing MS was the advent of the MRI scan. Before 1980s, the first MRI scan on someone with MS was actually done in 1981 in England. Before that, it was hard to diagnose MS. And why is that? Many of the symptoms of MS are invisible. How do you tell if someone has fatigue? How? You can't look at them. There's nothing that waves and says, I have fatigue. It's hard to tell fatigue. Many people that had fatigue or other invisible symptoms, memory loss, even tingling and numbness, how do you tell that? It's very hard to determine those symptoms. And in those days, in the 1980s, people were often told, well, you're lazy, right? You're lazy. That's why you're not trying hard. It's in your head. Of course, it was in their head. But it was hard to diagnose MS until we had the MRI scan. So the MRI scan was a huge advance. It's probably on the next slide, too. Was a huge advance, not only in diagnosing MS, because a CAT scan is a waste of time for MS. So the MRI scan was a huge advance for us in diagnosing MS. And more importantly, in following MS, how are you doing? How is your MS doing? Is it time to change? The MRI helps us with that. And in research trials, how effective is a drug? So the MRI scan has been a huge advance. The first clinical trial in MS actually was done over 30 years ago, and that was using something called ACTH, or ACTHAR, which was used to treat relapses. And that was the very first trial. Subsequently, we've had many other trials. Later, we said bacteria and viruses were found, and we found in people with MS, we found if we examined their blood that there were antibodies to bacteria or viruses. Even to this day, we know that if you look at the blood of someone that has MS, they have antibodies to mono. So mono might be a trigger. So we think antibodies and viruses could be a trigger for MS. They don't cause MS. They're probably the trigger. And the earliest studies of MS started in the 1970s and 1980s. I spoke to you already about the importance of MRI scans. And the summation of all of this is, what do we know about MS? In MS, the actual disease is an autoimmune disease or an immune-mediated disease. And this is our current thinking. It could be we change that over time. So the actual disturbance, the disorder in MS, is your immune system that is malfunctioning. And in the case of MS, the target of the immune attack is your central nervous system, which is the brain, the spinal cord, and the optic nerves. The immune system malfunction could target other areas. It could target your joints, and then you'd have rheumatoid arthritis, or your skin, and you might have psoriasis. But in MS, the target of this autoimmune attack is the brain, the spinal cord, and the optic nerves, and there is initially inflammation. And so the earliest stage of MS is the relapsing stage with inflammation, and later we know that MS may progress. It's a stage when there is more degeneration, and we'll talk some more about that in a short while. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about clinical trials. Now, we said the first clinical trial for MS was, in fact, in 1970s and early 1980s is when the clinical trials were held, over 40 years ago. The first one was with Acthar. Later, there was a clinical trial with something called copolymer 1, which we know today as Copaxone, and then interferons. A clinical trial is the way any drug gets approved. Without a clinical trial, we would have no drug at all. So in my mind, people that enter clinical trials are, in fact, heroes. They are people taking a risk, because with a clinical trial, we don't always know what the outcome is going to be. But the purpose of a clinical trial is to determine certain facts about a drug. Most importantly, two facts. Does it work, and is it safe? And so we have different phases of clinical trials. Phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. The phase 3 trial is the trial before approval of a drug. That's when a larger number of people are involved, and we finally can establish some efficacy of the drug, some safety of the drug, and know how to monitor and screen for a drug. So phase 3 clinical trials are the ones that ultimately lead to approval of a drug. Once it's approved, sometimes we have something called a phase 4 clinical trial. This tells you that in the 1980s and 1990s, there was an explosion of trials for MS. And if you ever want to know about trials that are going on for MS, relapsing MS, progressive MS, MS symptoms, you go to this site I listed over there. It's called clinicaltrials.gov. That's the site you need to go to, clinicaltrials.gov. And if you have a look on that site, there are more than 900 studies on MS that have been reported since 2000, 900. And this is on all aspects of MS, treatments, symptoms, and there are 300 ongoing or planned studies. That is the quote from the MS Society. And so the historical facts that I quoted to you were provided by Dr. Lauren Rolak, who is a very well-known neurologist in Wisconsin. Dr. Rolak, actually, I did my neurology residency at Baylor College in Houston. And when I was there, Dr. Rolak, at that time, was one of my residents. So I did know him well. And just to tell you the era of that, that was in the era of Bum Phillips. So I'm sure a few of you are familiar with Bum Phillips. What a character he was, and the Houston Oilers. But that's when I worked in Houston at Baylor College, and Lauren Rolak provided most of the historical stuff that I've told you about. So going forward now, with that history of what MS is and where it comes from, we're trying to identify risk factors like you do for every other disease. If you're diabetic, or you have high blood pressure, or any other disease, we're trying to identify what are the risk factors so we can effectively treat you and try and treat, be preventive. And so the first thing we know is a geographic factor. That the further that people live from the equator, the higher the risk of MS. If you live in Northern America or Northern Europe, there's more MS than people that are close to the equator. But everything has exceptions. For example, if you look at the Inuit people, which are otherwise known as Eskimos, the incidence of MS is rare. But for the most part, if you're more north, northern latitudes, a higher risk of MS. And it's where you grow up that counts in the first 15 years or so of your life. That's the important part of that. And then we know there is genetic susceptibility. So MS is not a directly inherited disease, but there is susceptibility. If somebody in your family has MS, then you have a risk for MS. The risk in the general population is The risk in the general population is 0.1%, about 1 in 1,000. In first-degree relatives, it's about 3 to 4%, so it would be about 30 times higher. So I stress that the risk in the general population is about 1 in 1,000. So that's a risk factor, too. So you have genetic risk factors. And then vitamin D. We can talk more about vitamin D in a short while, too. Vitamin D. Low vitamin D is a risk factor. Very important. Right from the time of pregnancy, in a pregnant woman's children, vitamin D is a risk factor. Microorganisms. Those are bacteria and viruses. And they're coming to be more and more important, especially the microorganisms or bacteria that live in our gastrointestinal tract. So the microbacteria, the bacteria and the viruses, or especially the bacteria that live in our gastrointestinal tract, we call that the microbiome. So if you read somewhere about the microbiome and MS, we're starting to get the importance going forward about how important is what we eat. It truly might be that we are what we eat going forward. It could become very important. Here is another one that becomes important now and also related to diet, and that is obesity. And what they've shown is that obesity, especially in adolescent females. So let's look at some of these risk factors. You have someone that has MS, and then they have a 20-year-old daughter who is vitamin D deficient maybe and overweight. This is increasing the risk for MS. And so it's very important to pay attention to diet. And then the microbiome I mentioned, and then finally the risk of smoking. So here's some risk factors we can identify. And we can hopefully address these and trying to be preventive. Now, this shows you over here the definitions of MS that we've had over time. And so in the past, you know, we used to say there was relapsing remitting MS and then progressive types of MS. And this shows you on the left-hand side, the left two, if you look at the left two tables, those are what are called CIS and RRMS. And those are what we would call, let's see if it populates. Okay, let me leave it like this now. So the two types are called relapsing forms of MS. So clinically isolated syndrome was someone that had their very first episode. And we looked at their, listened to what type of episode it was, and looked at the scans, and we said there's a high risk for MS developing, and we called it, but it's the first episode, so we weren't sure that we could absolutely call it MS, and we called it a clinically isolated syndrome. And then we go into what used to be called relapsing and remitting MS, and we're tending maybe more to call that relapsing MS. Because the word remitting in MS is really a false word. Because if you think of the word remission in cancer, what does that mean? It means you're free of cancer. But with MS, we know if someone is in remission, there's no freedom from MS. We could do a scan when someone feels well and still see active disease or new lesions. So we rather call it relapsing MS. And then there is the progressive type of MS. Some people progress right from the beginning. That's called primary progressive MS. Some people used to be relapsing and then start to progress. That's secondary progressive MS. And so we're talking now maybe of relapsing and progressive forms of MS. And going forward, this could be the way we can are going to consider MS in the future. What happens if you don't treat MS? Is it important to treat MS? And so we know from studies that have been done in the past what happens. The first drug approved for MS, I've told you before, and we'll talk about again, was beta-cerin in 1993. So we have studies that were done before 1993 that are telling us what happens if you don't have MS. And we know that about 10% or 20% of people maybe have benign MS. These people have very few attacks, and this means that when we examine them at 10 years after the diagnosis, they pretty much have no disability. And we call that benign MS. You can't really diagnose it very well at the beginning, but after 10 years, you might look at it. About 5% of people have what's been called malignant MS, which is very severe MS, rapid accumulation of disability, wheelchair or bed bound. But what happens? People have MS at the beginning and they don't take treatment. Again, from Mayo Clinic studies done and reported 25 years ago, we know that 15 years after the diagnosis, 50% of people have progressed. And at 25 years after the diagnosis, 80% of people have progressed. And progression is variable. It could just mean a limp, it could mean a cane, it could mean a wheelchair. But at 25 years after the diagnosis, 80% of people have progressed. And so someone could say, well, 20% haven't. That's true. But this is what the odds are. And these are studies that were done in the Mayo Clinic reported before the advent of medication. So we know this tells us we should treat people that have MS. And how do we know? Can we look at you and judge the symptoms you have and try and predict how you're going to do? And this actually over here, what you're seeing in front of you, is a table that I actually have in my office, and it's laminated. And when I'm discussing treatments with my patients, I discuss this with them, these risk factors. This was a paper by Tom Scott, and he said there are 6 risk factors, and other people have done similar studies saying what are the risk factors. And age at onset could be a risk factor. So we know the typical age of onset of MS, you know, is 20, 45, that range. Symptoms at onset are important. For example, if there are brainstem symptoms or spinal cord symptoms, bowel and bladder problems early on, these are very important symptoms that could indicate a worse outcome as opposed to milder symptoms such as, let's say, optic neuritis. And what does the MRI look like? That helps us predict as well what the outcome is going to be. And then how many attacks you have in the first few years and how long between the attacks. And then how much recovery there is. And if we look at these 6 factors and analyze them, we can predict how someone is going to do and say, you on this scale are looking either quite mild right now or maybe not, and maybe we need to be changing our therapies and ready to switch more readily. This shows you on the MRI scans, and firstly, I want you to look on your left-hand side, and that shows you essentially a person that could come into your office, into our office, and have their first symptom. And we would look at their brain scan and say, from your brain scan, can we predict what your risk of MS is? So if you look on the left-hand side, it says 0. That means someone has a symptom that sounds like MS. Let's pick any symptom, let's say optic neuritis, and they have no lesions on their brain scan. What's their risk for developing MS? About 20% over the next 10 to 20 years. Let's say they have one lesion. What's their risk of developing MS? Even one lesion, and we're talking about an MS lesion, looks like an MS lesion, the risk of developing MS is 80%, just one lesion. And if there's 10 lesions, what's their risk? It's the same. So any lesions that you have give you the same risk, this 80% risk of developing MS if you're diagnosed early. Now look on the right-hand side, what does that tell us? That tells us, though, that if you have more lesions, you're going to do worse. So the risk of getting MS is the same, but the more lesions that you have early on, the worse that the outcome is going to be. For example, if somebody has more than 10 lesions, there's a high chance that within 10 years they're going to be ambulating at least with a cane, so they're going to be more disabled. I don't know how this came out. I don't know how well can you see this on your screens. But this to me is an amazing slide, because this is a list of all the medications that have been approved for MS since 1993. So now if you think about this slide, I should have put up a blank slide for you here, because in 1993 we had no drugs for MS. All we had in 1993 in people that have serious aggressive MS, we tried chemotherapy, but we had nothing else. And then in 1993, beta-serum got approved. So that's the first drug that got approved, beta-serum 1993. And then after that, over the next decade or so, we had a series of more injectables. And then the next medication that came out was Tysabri, our first infusion. And more recently, the past 1.5 years, we have another infusible drug, which is Lemtrada. In between, we have 3 oral medications. So we have a huge amount of MS drugs. We have over 15 agents that are approved, and we have more coming. And this is, I'm not going to spend much time talking about these drugs, except to show you this table, which is chronological. And this is a table of all the drugs that are approved, dividing them into classes. The one that I did leave out of this class is Novantrone, the chemotherapy drug that has been approved for treating MS. Novantrone was approved for treating relapsing MS and secondary progressive MS, the only drug that was approved for secondary progressive MS. But Novantrone is very toxic, and I personally have not used Novantrone for several years. There are still some people that might use it in very aggressive cases, but I have not used it for years. So this is an amazing list. When you think about in April 1992, 93, or go back to 1992, we had nothing. And now we have a choice. Now we have medications. So we can try and pick the right choice for someone. We can try and personalize your treatment, pick what the best medication might be for you. The reason I put this one up over here, except it's not on the list, is because this drug is not available yet. This drug is before the FDA, and hopefully by December we'll hear about it. What's great about this drug? Well, this drug is a drug that is approved and effective for relapsing MS, and no doubt will be approved for relapsing MS, but it's the first medication really that's been shown to be of benefit for primary progressive MS. So for the past 23 years since beta-serum was around, you could ask the question, and I had that question every time, and all of us that speak heard the same question: what is there for primary progressive MS? And the answer was, there is no FDA-approved drug to help modify the disease. So we have to be intent about what I spoke to before about that team effort, exercise, diet, doing all the right things. But there was no actual drug. And now, here is something coming. Hopefully in the next few months, this drug will be approved. This is the reason I mentioned this separately from everything else. This is going to go on that page before. That page is getting longer and longer. Our goal going forward with all these new drugs and the clinical trials is to find a drug. And so when we look in clinical trials, we're trying to find a drug that may have no evidence of any disease activity. So when you're in the clinic and you say to your neurologist, you say to your nurse practitioner, you say, how am I doing? And we can look at 3 things. We're going to say, are you having relapses? Is there any progression of your disability? And how does your MRI scan look? These are the ways we're going to measure the effectiveness of the drug: with relapses, with disability, and with MRI scans. So if you look at this table over here, this diagram, you'll see that we're looking forward. Is there a drug going forward that can do all these things? Maybe we have no relapses, no progression of disability. Your MRI scan shows no progression, and we call that NEDA, or no evidence of disease activity. And going forward, you may read about this with trials where we're looking for drugs that have no evidence of disease activity. And how do we decide what to switch you to? And sometimes people just will look in the office and say to me, what would you pick? And I'm saying, well, this is not a simple decision. This is something we need to spend time about. Look at these things we have to think about. We've got to think about all these things. What's the safety of the drug? We could pick the drug for you. What's the safety? What's the efficacy? What's the tolerability of the drug? All these things we have to think about. What's involved with monitoring? How convenient is it? Do you like injections or not? What's the cost? We might spend 45 minutes picking a drug for you, and then the insurance company says, nope, can't do. So we've got to think about that too. Pregnancy issues. Is it a woman of childbearing age? We may have different concerns. your general health. There's many other things, the mechanism of action. So the treatment decision as to what medication to give you is a complex one. It doesn't happen overnight. We need to research things and try and personalize it and individualize for you. It doesn't come about easy. We have to think about a lot of things. In addition to all the medications or the medication you could be taking for MS, look at this long list over here. This is the drugs you could be on to treat your MS symptoms. Look at them. There's a long list. This in itself, you know, we could spend hours talking about. We could treat fatigue or depression or spasticity or pain or your bladder or your bowel or walking medications. I mean, there are a long list of medications that we could be giving you. So what's the result of all of this? Polypharmacy. Very important. Consider all the medications you could be taking. So not only are you taking your disease-modifying drug for your MS and a drug for your MS symptoms, you could be taking drugs for other conditions. People could be diabetic, hypertensive. There's other conditions they have. And we need to look at these drugs and make sure we have no interactions. This could be a problem. And that is the importance why you saw right at the beginning of filling in this information when you go for your doctor's visit. Let your doctor know what drugs you're on. It's very important. And I've said this one before, but I'm going to repeat it again because it's so important. At the bottom of the list on that communication tool that we use, and different people might have their own tools that they like. That one that you saw earlier is one that I use in my office. And it says there, list of medications and supplements. And some people will write on there, the same. It's most unhelpful. My goal is to do the best that I can for you. And when you say the same, what happens? Now I have to go and look at my chart in my computer, open the computer, and go through the drugs and say, this and this and this. Almost every time there's something different. Write the drugs down, please. Tell your doctor what you're on. It's very important so we can look at the big picture. And I can glance at that in a second. And I don't have to waste that second reviewing, going into the computer and wasting 3 or 4 minutes looking up your medications. There's no such thing as the same. Has anybody ever been to Walgreens and asked them for the same? I went to the drive-up window. I said, can I get the same? And they looked at me like I'm like a crazy person. And then I said, okay, if you don't have the same, do you have unchanged? How about unchanged? And then they're really looking at me. And, you know, they're pretty much going to call 911 any minute because... So it's very important. You must give your doctor information. There's no such thing as too much information. Because if you write things down, we can look at them. And we can quickly analyze and decide what to do. So going forward, what do we need to do with MS? We need some biomarkers. And that is some measurement. With MS, one of the problems about the diagnosis, remember, it's hard to diagnose MS. Even now, MRI scans help us. We have other things. We have spinal fluid. But it's still hard sometimes to make a diagnosis. Much easier than it used to be, but it's still difficult sometimes. So going forward, and what kind of MS does someone else have? And what kind of medications are they going to respond to? Are there some ways? And so we have biomarkers. Things maybe blood tests that we can do that are going to tell us what kind of MS this person has, or what kind of drugs they're going to respond to. We call those biomarkers in the future. What's another need? Improving our disease-modifying drugs. We have new drugs. They're more potent. There's safety issues. Going forward, maybe we want potent drugs that have maybe less safety issues. Stem cells, further development of stem cells. Dietary aspects. I spoke to you before about the gastrointestinal tract and the microbiome and how important that is in MS. And going forward, I have no doubt that dietary aspects and dietary management could become very important. And then, of course, improving our symptom management. So these are future needs and directions. Compounds in clinical trials. So I'm going to mention to you some of the drugs that are coming up. And so the first drug was lecanemab. Lecanemab is a drug that was already tried for relapsing MS. And the efficacy, the reduction of relapses was not very powerful. And so the drug was not, they never went forward with it in that way. But it did seem to have some good benefit in slowing down disease progression and brain atrophy. So there is an ongoing study of lecanemab looking at two things. Number one is using a higher dose to see if higher doses will actually reduce the number of relapses. And secondly, to see if it's got some benefit in slowing down or improving primary progressive MS. So here's another drug going forward. We're talking again now about something that might help progressive MS. And then second generation S1P modulators. Let me explain that to you. An S1P modulator, this is referring to the way the drug works. And the classic example of an S1P modulator is fingolimod. Just remember that M-O-D at the end of it, that's Gilenya. So we have other drugs in that family of Gilenya or fingolimod, and we're developing drugs maybe that will have less cardiovascular side effects. And you'll see at the bottom there, it talks about the EXPAND study. And the EXPAND study was used for secondary, and that's why I'm showing you this as well, was used in secondary progressive MS, and it reduced disability progression in people with secondary progressive MS. So again, now we can start talking about medications for progressive MS. Here's another drug, siponimod, that might help in secondary progressive MS. And the early results were published and were beneficial. And there are other drugs in this same class as fingolimod and siponimod that are being tried. Here's some other trials that I just listed for you. I'm not going to go over all these medications, but you can look through these medications. Some are common names, like statins. Statins have been tried. Some studies have shown benefit, some have not. There was a study that showed some benefit in slowing down progressive MS, but the dose of statin that they used was very high. They use simvastatin, 80 milligrams a day, a very high dose. So it has been tried. It may be beneficial. Even antibiotics like tetracyclines or doxycycline have been tried, minocycline. They're looking at a bunch of different agents that are used to try and help. Vitamin D and biotin I'm going to talk about in more detail. Let's talk a little bit about stem cells. So the primary type of stem cells that we're talking about in MS, and you read it there, it's called HSCT. That stands for hematopoietic stem cell transplant. And the goal of this treatment is to reset your immune system. So remember, in MS, the problem with MS is you have a diseased immune system. And so our first purpose with this type of stem cell is to replace your immune system. So they take out, the people that do this, they will take out stem cells from your bone marrow and freeze them and process them and put them aside. And then your own immune system will be destroyed with chemotherapy. And then we have to put these stem cells back into you, otherwise you've got no immune system. So immediately these stem cells are thawed and put back into you, and now your immune system regenerates. And how does it regenerate? And the word we use is maybe it reboots. We're hoping that's what it does, that it reboots and that it resets, and that the new immune system does not act in the way your immune system used to act, and these bad cells that used to attack your myelin and cause inflammation are no longer there in the new immune system. So this is the major type of stem cell transplant that we're using now for MS. So very important to stress, the purpose is to reset your immune system. We'll talk a little more about this on the next, it's on the same page. There are other types of stem cells. There's mesenchymal stem cells and pluripotent stem cells. You'll learn more about these. And so what are these? I've told you that what the immune system does is reset your immune system. Even with that, you can improve. But now going forward, we're looking for maybe stem cells that will help myelin regrow, maybe help nerve fibers, maybe actually improve your MS. That's going to come from the other type of stem cells, which is in the very early stages of research. I've put over here some of the places where stem cells have been studied. Firstly, in London, in England, at the Sheffield Teaching Hospitals. The major site in the US, Richard Burt at Northwestern University, has studied many patients. And you'll see at the bottom of some of patients who were followed for more than 4 years, most of them remained relapse-free. And after 2 years after the transplant, 50% of them had shown improvement in disability. So we restored their immune system. Their nervous system had a chance maybe to recover. The actual stem cells don't cause the recovery. It's that the immune system is no longer attacking the nervous system, so your nervous system potentially could recover. And then there's some other studies. Recently, there was a study from Ottawa reported where they followed about 24 patients. And there's been a study reported from Washington State. So there's ongoing stem cell work, which is also very encouraging. This goes back to when we go to the land of MS and all the things we're going to try and accomplish in your office visit: make the diagnosis, treat the relapse, the disease management therapies, treat your symptoms, the importance of self-management, what you do for yourself, being part of the team. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this whole thing. This in itself is a program. It's self-help. And I have an acronym that I made up for it. I change this every 6 months. And this is an acronym. It's called Teams of Friends. And these are all things that you're involved with. It's a very important part of the team. So, and we can quickly read them. T, temperature expectations. You're going to hear more about this after I'm done. Your expectations are very important. What do I expect my drug to work to do for me? Adherence, the importance of taking your medication. Mental aspects. Memory aspects, cognitive aspects, the importance of sleep, your outlook, having a positive outlook, management of fatigue, food, relationships, interactions, exercise, the importance of exercise, news, keeping up with the news, being educated. This is an example coming to programs. vitamin D. I put that separately from food because it's so important. And then smoking. I've got a slide here on what I call defensive nutrition. This is a general topic. This applies to everyone, which is, you know, this is what we learned from before. Eat breakfast. This is what our grandparents told us. I guess now I'm the grandparent, but eat breakfast. Don't skip meals. Fat facts, more fiber, more plants, fluid supplements, defensive nutrition, and what I call defensive dining. So it's not only important as to what you eat, which is the content, but also the calories. So you could be a vegan or a vegetarian, say, I'm eating healthy, but you eat too much of the wrong thing, it's no good either. So watch the calorie content as well. And then sharing portions. So this is a question I ask. I've not done this program with your group, so I can ask you the question, who do you share with? Anybody want to volunteer an answer? Who do you share with? Yourself. That's what I say. So most portions in most restaurants are too large. You do not need that amount. So therefore, what you do is the minute they bring the food, ask them, you know, can I have a box to take some home? Spread it in half. Now, this doesn't apply in an expensive restaurant. An expensive restaurant, there's never enough, obviously. But if you've got a regular restaurant, they will bring you a large portion, separated, two portions. Take half of it and put it in a box that you take home. You've got another meal. And take what's on your plate, spread it out. I guarantee if you sit and you dine and you eat it, and there's no doubt that slower eating is better. So if you sit and you dine and eat it, you've got another meal and you'll be healthier. Reduce the portion, share portions, eat slower. Put the salad dressing on the side. Make sure you get low-fat salad dressings. Watch out for alcohol. Alcohol's got lots of calories. And then the three bad S's, salt, sugar, and saturated fats. Sugar is bad for everybody. Just some plants that you should pay attention to. Vitamin D. Let's talk about vitamin D becoming very important in MS. So on the surface of cells in our body, not only all over the body, lymphocytes, cells in the bone marrow, all over the body, there are many cells that have receptors on them. And it's amazing if you think of the tiny size of a cell that they have thousands of receptors on them. And there are vitamin D receptors where the vitamin D attaches to the surface of the cell. And in order for vitamin D to be fully effective, we believe in terms of its immune actions, that you need to have a level of about 75. So if you say to me, what's your level of vitamin D? How much should you take? I don't know how much you should take until I measure your level. So I want to measure your level of vitamin D, and then I can tell you how much to take. And I'm saying aim for about 75. They have done some studies with vitamin D and found that low vitamin D levels were a warning sign that people had a higher risk of progressing from early on to develop more progressive MS. They have reported on a study on children of mothers with vitamin D deficiency. So if you look at records, if you go back to some Scandinavian countries, they have your records, National Health, they have your records from forever. And they went back and looked at some children with them, some people with MS, and then looked at their mother's health records and saw that mothers who were vitamin D deficient during pregnancy, their children had an increased risk of developing MS. So vitamin D is very important at all stages of life. Let's talk a little bit about biotin. It's going to become exciting, I hope. And biotin is a water-soluble B vitamin. It's found in some foods, but there's no high dietary source. And the normal daily dose is 30 to 100 micrograms. And we think that biotin could be important in MS in a variety of ways. And so now there is a new study ongoing with a biotin. And this study uses a very high dose of biotin, a very highly concentrated, high-grade biotin. The dose is considerably higher than the dose I read to you on top, where you read that the normal daily dose is 30 to 100 micrograms. The dose in this study is about 300 milligrams daily. You can't do that in the pharmacy. So there's a study going on, and this drug was beneficial in people with progressive MS that resulted in significant improvement in some of the symptoms. So this is a drug that could be very interesting, a simple vitamin that's being studied to help people with progressive MS. Salt. We spoke about the bad S words. Salt. So salt intake. You should not cook with salt. Find some other seasoning. There's tons of others. Or use low salt. You should not add salt. And so they've done studies where they've looked at the intake of salt, and people that had high amount of salt, their relapse rates were greater than those who had a lower amount of salt. So it's becoming important for us. There are people, every time you say salt is bad, there are people that tell you, well, it's not so bad. But I think all the evidence is pointing more and more that it's very important to pay attention to your salt intake. unsaturated fatty acids. This goes back a long, long time. If you think of Dr. Swank, I'm sure many of you know of Dr. Swank and the Swank diet. It's the classical MS diet. And Dr. Swank wrote this book over 50 years ago. And he said that saturated fatty acids are bad and we should concentrate and maybe try and get in polyunsaturated fatty acids. And so, in fact, there have been some studies reported recently that have shown polyunsaturated fatty acids, whether you get them from a vegetable source or a fish source, and two different studies were somewhat different in terms of which they said was more important. But if you eat polyunsaturated fatty acids, then they could be important for you and help. And they have some direct effects. We've spoken before about your gastrointestinal tract. So your gastrointestinal tract is the biggest part of your immune system, actually. If you looked at what it looked like, there are a huge amount of immune cells in the gastrointestinal tract. And changing your diet can actually modify some of these immune cells in your gastrointestinal tract. And we can see how all this is kind of coming together. Here it is, that the dietary fatty acids influence the T cells in your gastrointestinal tract. I spoke to you previously about obesity. And if you have a high BMI, that increases the risk for MS. So they looked particularly at women, young girls, overweight and compared to non-overweight. Those who were overweight at puberty or age 25 had a significantly earlier age of onset of their MS. Could MS begin in the gut? I've already introduced a lot of this along the way, telling you about how important the gastrointestinal tract is. Dr. Howard Weiner is a foremost MS researcher who has spoken about this, the next MS, the next frontier in MS therapy, how what we eat could be important, that a large part of the immune system is in the gut, and different types of bacteria are found in the gut. And by changing the bacteria, we might be able to change how your MS is doing. And just this week, I mentioned to you before, there is a large MS meeting that happens every year in Europe. It's called ECTRIMS. And just this week, they're publishing results. Dr. Lloyd Casper and his group has looked at the bacteria in people with MS and compared those bacteria to people that don't have MS, and they're different. And the bacteria find that in people with MS are the type that promote inflammation. And so we need to, if we modify those bacteria, we might be able to reduce inflammation. And that would lead into a discussion of your diet again, maybe changing, maybe having some probiotics. And if anyone here has taken probiotics, the species they found particularly important were Bacteroides species. So we're learning more and more maybe about modifying the bacteria in our gastrointestinal tract and maybe having an effect on our immune system. I just threw this in over here. These are some of the books that I've and some of them that I've referenced that talk about the importance of diet in general, in addition to people with MS. But this is general. This implies to general health, except for Dr. Swank. But these others are very important in general health. So I kind of summarized it as the pillar, what I called, in my own mind, the pillars of MS that you need to do for yourself, which is the importance of vitamin D, paying attention to your diet, the salt, the sugar, the saturated fats, out. Avoid them when you can. No smoking. Do some exercise. There's exercise for everybody. Sometimes people will say they can't exercise. Maybe they can't walk very well. But then they can do seated exercises. Just move. Move your arms. Do some movement. Very important to do exercise. And then support in. It's great to get support in. And it's great to give support out, which means be part of a team. And people, maybe you volunteer. Maybe show appreciation. Just the same as when you have MS, it's great to meet a person that's patient and kind and compassionate. I think it works well when it goes both ways. And there's an amazing book called The Power of Kindness that just talks about how important kindness is in helping us. And there's a book that has been published by Dr. Hall that talks about the importance of psychological aspects just on our immune system. So all these things are tied together, your mental health, and how important it is, and this goes into trying to reduce stress as well. So exercise, your diet, stress, all the importance of all those things. Finally, what I want to talk about is how do we put this all together? And the way we put it all together comes together in our office visit when we talk about all the things that we've already been through. Why are you here? What are your symptoms? What are your medications and supplements? And maybe look at social facts. Maybe the point of that particular visit is only going to be to talk about some social aspects. It could be a loss of a job, which MS is stressful enough. It could be a loss of a job. It could be having a child that's on drugs. I mean, there are so many social and psychological effects, and that might be, so it's important to know about these things. On the form we have, we include that, your general health. And then there's a place for questions, and at the end of it, I typically will say to my patients, let's summarize the points. So this is the land of MS. This is what I use in my office. You'll see it's got all these different topics we talked about. It says, why are you here? What are your questions? What are your symptoms? please list all your medications and some other items. On this page, it talks about other factors, like are you still working, are you smoking, how is your level of stress, do you need any assistance? It asks questions like that, as well as covering all general aspects, general health, including things we go specifically here talking about the bladder and the bowel and the eyes. Things are very important for MS as well. But if you fill this in and bring this form in when you come for your visit, and your neurologist can glance at this literally in seconds, now we know, have a good summary quickly about where we're going for that visit. And it makes the visit much more valuable if we can do that. So with that, I thank you for your attention and wish you well. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Steingo. Did anybody of you learn something new? You all did? Good. I'm glad to see that. Good. So we'll have to have him back for the Q&A after. Okay. You can just set it down. All right. So next up, we're going to have Amanda Adcock, and she's a nurse practitioner coming down from Coleman, Alabama. All right. And she has worked up there for 5 years helping to treat MS patients. And I think there's even somebody in the room that knows her well. But let's introduce Amanda and say hello. Hey, how are you?
Hello.
Thank you for coming.
Hello. Yes, I see some familiar faces. That's always comforting. I'm going to talk a little bit today about adherence to these therapies that Dr. Steingo talked about and the impacts of disease management. So, I like this. Life is not what it's supposed to be. It's what it is. The way you cope with it is what makes the difference. So, I'm sure none of you ever expected to have MS. I'm sure none of you wanted to have MS. It is what it is. So now let's see what you can do to make a difference, what you can do to help. So, any of you feel like this? Very overwhelmed? Medication coming at you left and right? That list, I think, I don't know if it's long enough for a lot of people's medication because you keep compiling those, it seems, a lot of times. So sometimes things fall at the wayside, like your MS DMT, your disease modifying therapy. And I want to talk about why it's so important to stay on track with that. So different types of MS therapies. Sometimes my patients are very confused as to which medication I'm talking about, especially if they've already been on a disease-modifying therapy and I'm seeing them in follow-up, if somebody else prescribed it, or if we've not, you know, talked in detail about their medication, if they've been on it for so many years. And then I'll get in a conversation and I'll find out they think that maybe a symptom management medication is their disease-modifying therapy. So there's some differences here. There are three different types that we give with MS patients, and the first is the disease-modifying therapies that Dr. Steingo spoke of. Next is symptom management, and there's a variety of these, as he showed you a list as well. And then there's relapse management. Have you ever had some symptoms, some new disease, a relapse, and been put on steroids, IV steroids, or maybe Acthar, and that's not your actual therapy, but that's getting you over this hump, over this inflammation process that you've had. So why? Why do we want to be adherent to our therapies? Well, there's a lot of different reasons. I've listed just a few here. Strict adherence results in optimal function. Many studies have been done, and many studies do prove that. Improved quality of life. The more stable your MS is, a lot of times you have a better quality of life. You're able to get out, you're able to do things. Decreased inpatient and outpatient visits also lower the MS-related medical cost. So that's good for everyone. Reduction in the number of new lesions on MRIs. We'll talk about that in a minute. Reduction of progression of disability. That's a big part of what you all want. I know that a lot of the times the first question I get asked is, you know, am I going to be on a cane? Am I going to have to use a walker in a wheelchair? Well, I hope not. We want you to be on a therapy that's right for you to keep you stable so you won't have any progression in your disability. The reduction in future disease activity. And a reduction in the number of relapses. Those are what generally makes you feel terrible, and then a lot of times you'll have new disease and new relapses. And that's something I want to talk about a little bit. There's a little bit of confusion I have found in between what a true new disease relapse is and what we call a pseudo relapse, which is when your old symptoms kind of rear their ugly head and you start having these problems from those again. So a pseudo relapse, and it's pseudo, but it is very real, not meaning that it's not a real relapse. It is very real, sometimes very detrimental, and to you, keeps you in the house for days, weeks. It can have serious effects. But this, generally, when we talk about pseudo relapses, is not new disease. It's not a new area of damage. It is sometimes brought on by external factors, heat, stress, a urinary tract infection. Any of these things can kind of lower your threshold and make those ugly symptoms appear again. And these are not things that you really need the IV solumedrol for to decrease the inflammation. You can. There's other management, there's symptom management, but we need to find what's the cause, what's bringing out this old symptom that you have. Many times, my patients have no idea that they have a urinary tract infection. And that's usually the first thing that I will check. And sure enough, they'll have one. We'll treat it with an antibiotic, and then that old ugly symptom will go away. So it's not a new deficit. That's the pseudo relapse. A relapse, on the other hand, is new neurological deficits that last generally for more than 24 hours. And that's the definition. Of course, everybody's does not fall directly in that definition, but it is new neurological deficit or new MRI lesions. You see a few new spots or a new spot on your MRI. When you have new spots on your MRI, new lesions, and with each relapse that you have, you are 40 times more likely to have a permanent deficit. So this is, if you're on a therapy at this time, this is a breakthrough. You're having a breakthrough of your disease, so we need to talk about changing that. So some definitions. Let's talk about the difference in compliance and adherence. So compliance usually implies that it's a unilateral decision, that it's the expectation from your provider that they say you're going to take this and you're going to take it. Adherence, on the other hand, is where it's a mutual, a plan between the provider, between you and your provider, a plan that your provider supports and that you can follow. So I like the word adherence a lot better. So some statistics, 32 million Americans take three or more medications. That's a lot. More than 50% of Americans do not follow their provider's medication guidance. Non-adherence adds $290 billion to avoidable health care cost. 75% of Americans are expected to be non-adherent in any given time. And I know even among practitioners and nurses and alike that are on medication will get to talking sometimes and, oh, I stopped that a while back, or I don't take my blood pressure medicine anymore. And it's not just patients. Believe me, it is definitely 75%, or you'll take one dose but not take the other dose, but actual adherence to their therapy. And then 29% stop taking their medication before it runs out. How many of you have a lot of bottles of old antibiotics in your cabinet? Maybe you didn't finish. There's a tendency to, once you start feeling better, to stop taking this. It's the same thing with our MS therapies. Once you start feeling better, your MS stabilizes. I don't need this anymore. It's not doing anything. And that is very common. But the case in point is it is. It's doing its job. And that's why you are stable. And that's why you feel like you do. So what are some factors that affect adherence? Your readiness. The diagnosis, are you still in denial? It's a big, big thing to have your provider tell you that you have MS. Something sometimes you've been looking and trying to figure out what's wrong, and sometimes I've heard it's actually a relief by some of my patients because they've been trying to figure out what was wrong so long. But on the other hand, it's a lot of times patients are in denial. Are you in denial? If you're in denial of your diagnosis, then you're probably not going to be ready to become adherent to your therapy. How was your diagnosis delivered? Did your provider walk in and say, you have MS, going to put you on something, we'll see you in 2 months? Okay. And as sad as it is to say, I've heard it. Well, you don't have confidence in that provider. You don't have confidence in this treatment. Do you have trust? Do you have trust in them? The access to care, are they available? Can you get in to see them? If not, do they have a message system? Can you have questions answered? Will they sit down and answer questions with you? Psychosocial factors, some anxiety, fear. You're very scared, not only with the diagnosis, but with some of these therapies. You need to be comfortable and know and take these therapies and comfortable in what they do and how they're supposed to affect you. Depression. Depression is not talked about as much as I think a lot of times it should be, because depression with MS, I have found with my patients, is right up there on top of a list of symptoms. Well, sometimes with depression, you get to where you don't care if you take your medication or not. It doesn't matter because nothing matters. And I don't want you to get down to that level. These are other things you need to discuss. Support. It saddens me when patients will tell me, you know, my husband, sister, brother, mother doesn't even believe I have MS. They think I'm lying. They think I don't have MS because they don't walk with a limp or because you don't have a symptom that they can see. Well, if they think that, they're not going to be very supportive in taking your medication. Are you going to have to hide? Are you going to have to hide this from your husband? These are all important things. These are all things that affect adherence. Support systems, like support groups here, those are wonderful. You can speak with other people, other patients that may be on the same therapies or may have tried those therapies. And it's not the same for everyone, but at least you can discuss your experience. Insurance, we talked about insurance. You know, this one may be the right one for you in all aspects, but then your insurance won't pay for it, like was said earlier, and you know, you can't do it. So there's another thing that affects adherence. Cognitive dysfunction, very big. Forgetting, just completely forgetting to take it. Understanding the disease, understanding what MS is and how to treat it, understanding the relapses, as we spoke of before, and your perceived benefits, expectations. What do you expect to get out of this therapy? Because if you're expecting for it to resolve all of your old symptoms, it's probably not going to do that. And if that's your expectation walking out of that office, then it doesn't do that in a month, you're probably not going to take it. So you need to see, what are your expectations? What benefit is it supposed to have? What is the perceived benefit for you? And then adverse events. These are always big, big keys that affect adherence. Side effect profiles, needle fatigue. A lot of times these can be discussed beforehand, and that way you'll be ready for those. So some strategies to improve. Find your match with your provider. Find a provider that you feel comfortable with, that you can sit down and ask these questions to. Don't go in somewhere and be scared to ask them a question. Well, I know they're busy. I don't want to bother them. No, this is your life. This is you. You have every right to sit down and ask whatever questions that you feel comfortable and you need to ask. And that tool is very good, because sometimes when you're in there on the spot and this person's looking at you, you know, you go blank. I do a lot of times. So that tool is extremely important. You can list that way you can go in armed. Follow-up visits are very important. You know, you probably, after you start a disease-modifying therapy, you don't need to wait a year before you go back and see that provider. Those are important things. The nursing help that I talked about earlier, can you ask questions? Or then, you know, do you feel comfortable at the clinic, not only with your provider, but everyone helping? You know, questions, they'll alleviate your fear a lot of times. There's no dumb questions at all. You can ask a question and it may be huge in your head and you thinking that it's very, very, very significant, and a simple explanation or answer can make it go from right here to here. So go ahead and ask that. Risk versus benefit with a lot of these therapies. The newer therapies, there's more risk. There are more risk involved with a lot of the newer therapies, and that's why there's kind of a step approach with some. Are you okay with those risks? Are you okay with the risk-benefit ratio? Be your own advocate. We spoke about that. Support groups, very important. Patient assistance, there's if you cannot, even though maybe your insurance covers a medication or doesn't cover it well, your copay's high, there are many of these programs have patient assistance. That is definitely worth looking into. The expectations I spoke of, and then side effects. There are some things to manage side effects. If you speak with your provider, you know, what should I expect here? Am I going to have an upset stomach for a few weeks? They should be able to tell you, whenever you choose the right DMT for you, what side effects are generally seen with this. Now, yours may be different. You may experience something that nobody else has. That happens too. But the general side effects that they have seen with their other patients or they have seen in the trials, they should be able to talk with you about. And that way, maybe if you know about them and know kind of how to combat those, it'll be a little bit easier to kind of get over that initial hump. Things you can do, you know, aspirin, ibuprofen can help with the inflammation of your injections, cold compresses, some of this oral medicine. If you take it with food, there's some you don't have to take with food, what specific kinds of food you need to take it with, and then dose titration. A lot of times with injectables, you'll start at a low dose and then you'll titrate up, and there's a few others you can do that with as well if you're not tolerating them at first. Information is key. MS Views and News, on the YouTube channel, is very, very helpful. If you have some extra time, just go through and pick out a few and listen, and you'll learn a whole lot. I promise I do. Every single time I pick somebody new to watch, I learn something different. So different providers have different theories, aspects on different things, and it is very, very helpful. And then you can kind of compare the two and figure out kind of where you fit. The MS Society, MS One-to-One, these are all resources, very good resources that you can look to. So forgetting is the most commonly reported reason for not adherence. Any of you look like this sometimes? Yeah. Anybody ever get in the shower and think, did I wash my hair yet? Oh, I'll just wash it again. Well, yeah. I mean, you've got not only MS, which interferes with your memory a lot of times, but life in general. Grandkids maybe having 10 things, your children, you have to go. There's a lot of things involved. So forgetting is very, very common, not only with medication, but other things. So there's different ways that you can maybe help. There's a neat thing I saw the other day, a medication alert watch. Just a regular watch, and then it beeps and tells you what you need to take when, and then you hit the button on it, and then it goes into like an app on your phone where you're tracking, so it, you know, check, took that. So then when you think, did I take it or did I not? Well, let's see. It'll show you. The blister packs, even though I have heard from a few of my patients that those are hard sometimes to get those out, especially if you have any problems, tremors or anything like that. Maybe you could have somebody help with those first. But if you have the blister packs and you're able to use those, you know, you can look and see. A smart pill container, much like the watch I was talking about, when you flip open that lid, as long as you go ahead and take your medicine at that time, it sends a message to an app. The mobile technology is phenomenal these days. You can combine it with a daily task. My mother always told me to take my medication put it beside my toothbrush. I would always remember to take it because hopefully I would brush my teeth every morning. So that's what I usually did if I ever had to be on an antibiotic or anything along those lines. set an alarm, any types of alarm, and keep it visible if you're able to. If you have children or pets, I know sometimes you can't keep it visible, but if you're able to, it's very helpful because if you walk by it 10 times a day, surely you'll remember to take it once. And then enlist help, friends, family, coworkers, have them maybe call if you're starting something new the first, you know, few weeks, and every other day, let them put it on their calendar, however the schedule is, and then let them help you. Okay, this is what we kind of want to get out of therapy. This was, my mentor came up with this, Dr. LeGank, and he called it his home run of therapy, and it's pretty easy to remember. These are the things that we want for you and that you probably want as well. We want you to have no changes on your MRI, none whatsoever, because even though you may be feeling well, 90% of new lesions do not cause symptoms. So it's going to, even though you're feeling great, you need to still have your MRI, because if you see new lesions, new disease, or a change, then that could mean detrimental outcomes for you. And we need to change that therapy right away. So no MRI changes. Well-tolerated safety, because if you don't tolerate it, or if it is, if you're having trouble with your injections, if it's making you sick at your stomach, you're most likely not going to take it. So it needs to be well tolerated. The safety profile, you need to talk about it. Well tolerated and safe, risk versus benefit. No relapses. We want you to get stable and not have any relapses, and that's what you want as well. And then stable on your neurological exam, because if you come in and we do a neurological exam and we find a new deficit, sometimes that you didn't even know you had, maybe finger weakness, arm weakness, then that may suggest some new activity, and of course we would follow up. But these are the things that we kind of look for in a disease-modifying therapy. And if it's not hitting the home run, then we might think about changing it. So what else can you do? What else can you do to help with MS? There is rehabilitation, all different types of rehab. Why would we need rehabilitation? If you've had this initial attack and you have some deficits, then you may need to relearn how to do these tasks. You've got to connect those wires again. You may need help learning how to walk again with this leg that you are disabled with now. You may need to learn how to appropriately use a cane. You may need some help with grooming. You know, you can't hold your arms up that high anymore. There are things that different rehab things can help you with. Benefits prevent falls, enhance moods, improve your quality of life, which, like I said, that's the key thing to everybody. So different types of rehab. There's physical therapy, occupational therapy, cognitive. This is not an all-inclusive list. There's also speech therapy. There are rehab centers. If you feel that you need rehabilitation in any of these areas, then speak with your provider about it and see if they can set you up with a referral to one of these places. And some providers have these located in their office. They can send you right over, or they can have the occupational speech therapist, whatever, come in and talk to you right then. And that's always wonderful. But if not, they can refer you to somewhere. There are different rehab centers. There's home health that does rehab, comes out. And they're doing studies now on group rehab, which I'm really interested to see that. Sounds fun. They will design a specific program for you and exactly what you need, designed specifically for you. They'll evaluate and assess you, and then you'll have whatever you need. And like I said, you help build new connections between those nerve cells. So the more rehab you do to those damaged areas, that you help to build back that connection, or at least find an alternate route for it. So what can it help with? Pain management, stretching techniques, strengthening, all this can help with your pain. Improve gait. And if you improve your gait, a lot of times that's going to help with your pain, because if you're now walking a different way than you've been walking before, then you could have some back pain. You could have some limb pain. So just show you how, and you may not even know a little bit that you're walking this way, but they can let you know, and this may be causing your pain. They can give you orthotics. If you have that foot drop, where sometimes your foot gets hung on, you know, there's something that just pops out and trips you every once in a while. That happens a lot, and it does happen. But you can, if you do have foot drop, then there are certain AFOs like ankle foot orthotics that you can use. There's a lot of different things that you can use there. Can show you how to use assistive devices, how to use them the proper way. Design exercise programs just for you. Water aerobics are very good. Yoga, range of motion. If you can't do a lot of these things, there's chair exercises, even range of motion, very helpful. Improve your posture, because if you improve your core strength, then it's going to help improve your posture, and it's going to help overall. And maybe even your awareness, your positioning. Do you slightly lean to the right and haven't noticed that at all? But it gets you off balance, and maybe you reach just a little too far and you'll go over. So the balance. There's different things that affect balance. Some say that dizziness and balance are not part of MS. I disagree. I think that it definitely is. Way too many of my patients complain of dizziness and being off balance and semi to a vertigo type thing. But you also need to make sure that that's not it. Is it vertigo? Are the crystals, that these little bitty crystals in your ear, they help keep you balanced? So is that it? Can they do some movements with your head that's going to fix that? So speak with your provider about this, and you know, maybe figure out the difference, and if there's something that you can do to fix it, then that would be great. If not, then these physical therapy will give you some ideas on how to balance that out. Maybe you need to rely more on your sight if your balance is off. They have many different things that can help. Occupational therapy can help you cope with a fatigue, can show you different energy conservation, cooling vest. They can show you how to pace yourself. They can show you how to arrange things so that you don't have to expend as much energy. There's home safety. They can come in and look at, are there barriers in your way? There's task related. They can give you alternate way of doing things, even simple things like moving something that you use frequently closer to you, and you might not have thought about that. Mobility devices, they can help you choose which one's right for you. And then there's speech therapy. They can do a swallow evaluation. If you're having problems swallowing, sometimes it's because that upper third of the esophagus there is a muscle too. So you have muscle spasms in other parts. You may be having muscle spasms there. But what we want to make sure of is that you're not swallowing and it going into your lungs, or you're not have an obstruction of some kind. So we need to figure out what the problem is so we can help you fix it or cope with it. And then cognitive rehab. They'll help you identify difficulties. They can do some neurocognitive testing, and a lot of these different tests can kind of show what area you may be weaker in, and then we'll know how to help you. Minimize your cognitive load. You know, help you do things like pre-made lists, different organizational things again, and then a routine. When you're in a routine, it's much easier. They always say, you know, put babies on a schedule. And I never really bought into that because I thought, I've got too much to do to put my kids on a schedule. Well, my nephew is now on a schedule, and it works perfectly. I kind of wish I would have tried it. But routine and schedule, that's very helpful a lot of times. There's many computer exercises and brain exercises, and then how to compensate for your memory loss or for different things. And then problem solving. So this is how I'm going to end. I don't know if you've seen this yet. One of my very best friends has MS, and she loves this poem, so I always like to share it. I love MS. It's just so neat, the way it swept me off my feet. I love the pain. I love the numb and sticking needles in my bum. I love the way my words are blur, the way I shake, the words I slur. I love my chair and walker, too. I love my MS. I do, I do. I love my lazy, sleepy days. I shake with joy within my haze. I'm just as happy as can be. It makes me pee and pee and pee. I love my legs that will not walk, my twisted tongue that will not talk. I love the way my poop does bind. I do believe I've lost my mind. So, thank you.
All right, let's thank Amanda. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. Now we're going to do something where a lot of people we know come to these programs, but we're always looking for the first person that's going to raise their hand. Dr. Steingo is going to come forward as well, and now we're going to start with our Q&A, okay? And these guys are going to be here to share a microphone, and Ken's on that side of the room, and I'm going to be on this side of the room, and we're going to alternate question to question, okay? So who's going to be first up on this side? I know somebody who said something, so I'm going to go to her first, but Ken's going to start down there.
You had said something about needle. I can't remember what it was.
Needle fatigue?
Yeah.
Yes. A lot of times after you've been on injections, beta serum's been out since 93. I have patients that have been on beta serum and will not change from beta serum, but beta serum is doing its job. However, at some point, you may get tired of giving yourself injections, or you may run out of spots to give yourself injections, and this is going to interfere with you taking your injections how you're supposed to take those. So if you get to that point, then that's a discussion you need to have with your provider. Right, and that happens, you know, often. That happens often, and if it comes to the point where you tend to skip doses or anything along those lines, then you need to talk to your provider about that, because if you don't take your therapy the way it's supposed to be taken, then it's not going to work for you. Hopefully you can talk to your provider about different maybe ways to help.
All right, next one's over here.
Oh, yes, I was wondering,
you're next.
My mom was wondering why people with MS have different symptoms, such as herself. She has low vision, and she's wondering why hers hasn't came back.
I didn't hear it completely. You're saying people with MS have different symptoms?
She wants to know why so many different symptoms and why she lost her vision, and her vision hasn't come back.
Yeah, there's no way to answer that. The fact is about MS, as we said before, it's a disease of the brain and the spinal cord and the optic nerves. So any of those areas could be involved. So MS has many, many different symptoms. And in any one person, it's unpredictable what's going to happen. That's why MS in some ways is very tricky for us to manage, because it's a very unpredictable disease. It can affect many different parts of the brain or spinal cord or optic nerves in many different ways. In different people are very different. The only thing about MS that's predictable is that it's unpredictable. It's a very unpredictable disease. There's no way of saying what will happen to one person or another. There's no way of predicting totally how much recovery. Somebody could have a relapse and then recover quite well. Somebody might not recover quite as well. So it's very unpredictable.
Over here.
You mentioned the stem cell therapy. That sounds similar to what I've heard for cancer therapy before, where they take your bone marrow and get your stem cells and then kill your bone marrow. Is it similar to the therapy for cancer?
It's the HSCT that I showed you is exactly the same. It's taking out your bone marrow, taking out the stem cells, processing them, freezing them, destroying your own bone marrow, and then re-injecting them. It's the same stem cell therapy you read about for leukemia, diseases like that. It is the same. Correct.
Next question here.
My question is, at times I will get a little dizzy and nauseated, and I have to sit down and wait till it goes away. And I had my eyes checked this year, and the doctor told me that I have glaucoma and I could go blind, but I was wondering if that may be a part of the MS or not.
It's really hard to tell. You would have to have an exam maybe to see It could be medication, different medication that's causing the dizziness. It could be blood pressure. It could be related to MS. It could be vertigo. There's lots of different things that can cause that type of dizziness. But you do need to discuss it with your provider so y'all can get to the bottom of it.
Well, I did have the test done. And when, excuse me, I did have quite a few tests done. And what he showed me was... you were showing about the immune system where the blood and all that runs together in the vein, and that's just about how it looked in the back of my eyes. So I'm by this being new to me, I haven't talked to too many people about it, but I would like to know more. And I did ask the doctor about it, and I didn't get too far. Mm-hmm.
You able to answer anything?
No. I mean, okay. So Amanda handed it back to me, but it's the same. There are many causes of dizziness. It can be due to a medication you're taking, a new antidepressant, a new medication for your bladder. There's many medications, and there are many other conditions that can cause dizziness. Inner ear problems can cause dizziness, so there's a large number of causes of dizziness. But glaucoma is not related to MS. Glaucoma is a separate condition. It's unrelated to MS.
On this side, sir.
Is there any research being done on dark matter in the brain as far as MS is concerned? And in the research, are there any medicines in other words, are they researching because one of the doctors had stated that MS also has, that there's dark matter that they haven't researched, or they are researching it and trying to figure that part of the MS out. Not only the white matter, which is the lesions, but there's also another aspect of it. Is that correct?
That's correct. I've not heard it called dark matter. Have you heard it called dark matter? So in the brain, I haven't heard it used that way. Normally what we use is you say white matter and gray matter.
Gray matter, okay.
Right. So gray matter is the surface of the brain, and deep inside the brain is also an area of gray matter. And it's a very thin area. It's much less amount of gray matter than there is of white matter. And the MRI scans do not visualize the gray matter as well as the white matter. So we're still quite a bit behind in studying gray matter. But we feel more and more, the more we know, that gray matter is very important. We just haven't studied it as much as we have studied white matter.
We know that there's effect.
Yes, there is effect.
There is effect, but there is no research to show how the effect is.
Well, the effect is that gray matter is involved. And the effect is that white matter that appears normal. So if you look at a scan, you do your scan, you look at it, and you see white spots in your scan, which you could call lesions or plaques or whatever name you want to give them, that's white spots, that's abnormal white matter. There's other white matter that looks normal. We call that normal appearing white matter. But when we've studied that, we know that that's also abnormal. So not only are the obvious things you see abnormal, like the white spots and the lesions and the plaques, but we know that the so-called normal appearing white matter is also abnormal, and there's some abnormalities in the gray matter too. That's still things that we're studying and learning more about.
I wanted to know the possible cost of the stem cell therapy.
Expensive.
What does it normally range? It's very expensive.
Expensive, yeah. If you do the legitimate stem cell therapies, what I call HSCT, that's very expensive. Okay. I think we're talking maybe 100 or hundreds of thousands.
Okay, thank you.
In the right, Dr. Burt in Chicago, with his study, has, I think it's part of a trial, but they're very selective in the people that they're, you know, would be admitted. They have very strict criteria. Any clinical trial has very strict criteria for who can get in the trial or not, and I think there's strict criteria, but it is expensive.
Thank you. Dr. Steingo, would you briefly touch on what me and you talked about in the hall as far as the difference between the studies or the stem cell treatments?
Oh. So we said that this that I show you, and I'll put the abbreviations because you'll read about them, HSCT, hematopoietic stem cell transplants, where they take out your bone marrow cells, they freeze them and they process them, and then essentially destroy your own bone marrow and then put the stem cells back into your system to reboot your bone marrow. That is legitimate stem cell therapy. That is expensive, because it's very complex, and we're still learning more about that too. That is definitely something that looks very promising for the future. There are other stem cells that can be done in the future, maybe using what we call mesenchymal stem cells, or pluripotent stem cells, other types of stem cells that we might try and teach them how to restore your myelin eventually. But we don't have that yet, because if we put stem cells into your body, how do they know where to go? The HSCT, the hematopoietic stem cells, go back to your bone marrow and repopulate your bone marrow. They're stem cells that go to the bone marrow. But how do we tell a stem cell to go to your brain and fix your brain up? How does it know where to go? It doesn't have a, it's not, there's no such thing. There's no, nothing we can make into a smart stem cell. It's not like a smartphone. There's no smart stem cell. There's no Steve Jobs to tell it where to go. There's no, it doesn't happen. So there are lots of scams out there where people tell you to come in and get stem cells, and they will give you stem cells that they take from your fatty tissues or from an embryo or something else. There is absolutely no scientific evidence that those work, and those are what are called transfer stem cells. They basically transfer the money from your pocket to their pocket. And be wary of those. They are not legitimate.
Thank you.
Question here.
I would add, you said something about the further from the equator, the further north, you got more. Correct. What if you lived on the equator?
On the equator? Yep, you'd be in pretty good shape. You'd be hot, but you'd be in pretty good shape. You'd have much less MS if you lived on the equator.
That's just a silly question.
But that's true. People in equatorial regions have much less MS than people that live in North America or Northern Europe or South. If you go way south in southern parts of Australia, same thing. People that live further from the equator, there is more MS.
Okay.
What is your opinion on having interferons in your system for 16 years that would suppress the T cells fighting the free radicals and possibly contributing to breast cancer when there's no history of breast cancer in your family?
I mean, we don't, so you're saying, let me repeat, try and understand your question. You're on interferons and then develop breast cancer down the road, or you're saying is it because the interferons had some effect on the immune system and led to the development of cancer? So. Yes, this is true with our newer drugs for MS that are potent drugs that modify the immune system, and the immune system is part of our vigilance. In our body, the immune cells are circulating, and they're helping us fight infections and maybe fight cancer. And if you suppress them in some way, we know that with the suppressing drugs, like the chemotherapy drugs, the immune suppressant drugs will lead to a higher risk of cancer down the road, maybe 10 or 20 years later down the road. But there is no evidence so far that the injectable drugs that we've known since the 1990s, the interferons or copaxone, I don't know of any evidence that they lead to an increased risk of cancer. So certainly MS is a disease that's more common in females than males by a ratio of about 3-1. And so things like breast cancer are seen, but I don't know of the interferons causing an increased risk of breast cancer. I wouldn't say I know that. Have you heard of that? No. Not the interferons. Maybe some of the newer drugs, we could be anticipating or wary of that. But with the older drugs, no, I don't think there's an increased risk of that. It's just seen in that population of patients.
Amanda, somebody had asked me to ask him, and I don't know if you spoke about it, but did you speak about anything to do with sleep apnea or hoarseness in voice?
I did not, but is there a specific question?
Yeah, the specific question they asked was, is there a relevance between sleep apnea or losing their voice often while they're working during the day? Is that associated with MS?
That can be associated with a couple of different things. One is sleep apnea.
Sorry.
It can contribute to your fatigue, your daytime fatigue. That's one of the things a lot of times we like to rule out, because if you're having excessive fatigue, even though it is definitely the number one symptom of MS, then you can, but you need to rule out other factors that may cause fatigue as well. I don't know so much about the hoarseness in the voice with that question. I think somebody had asked me previously at a previous about thyroid and hoarseness in the voice, and I had told them that sometimes if you have a thyroid goiter or a thyroid mass pushing against your vocal cords, you can have that hoarseness sometimes, and that can also contribute to some of the symptoms. So if you're thinking that there's a thyroid problem and that's the case, maybe that was the question. Per se, because I had answered that previously.
All right, over here.
About going back to the stem cell, when you take the stem cells out, you freeze them and you put them back in. How if you're putting your own stem cells back in, how is that going to not be putting back in the MS into your system?
Well, the stem cells are cells that are primitive cells. The stem cells themselves are not the cells that cause MS. As stem cells in your bone marrow grow into different cells, some of them grow into white blood cells and different kinds of white blood cells. And it's the, what they grow into, it's the cells they grow into that are the bad cells that have developed in the wrong direction and are directed toward attacking your nervous system. But the stem cells themselves are not the ones that are bad. And so when the stem cells go back into your bone marrow and now start to form a new crop of white blood cells, then hopefully they will not be the diseased white blood cells, because the stem cells themselves are not diseased. They're primitive cells. They're very basic cells that will grow into different kinds of white blood cells. And the hope is that when they grow back, they will be normal. And we've rebooted them, and they will not be diseased. That's the theory of that.
Doctor, you back to stem cells again. What you described as the goal sounded a lot like the drug Lemtrada to me, and I wonder if that's related or supposed to be a less side effect version or something, or more effective or something.
That's an interesting point from the fact that that's what Lemtrada does. Lemtrada works, and basically what it does is kills B cells and T cells, but not the rest of the bone marrow. And it kills the T cells and the B cells, and then they come back. They start to come back, and the B cells come back first, and then the T cells come back. And when they come back, we're hoping exactly the same thing. So there is some analogy there. And when they come back, we're hoping that the immune system has been reset by the recurrence of the cells coming back and hopefully coming back and not being the diseased line of cells. And so that is true. Lemtrada has some effect in that direction.
But were side effects possible?
Side effects?
I've heard of side effects pretty bad with Lemtrada.
No, there are definitely side effects, in fact, but in terms of the side effects we're seeing, the commonest side effect is the thyroid problems, which are generally very manageable. The side effects on the bone marrow have really not, even with the low lymphocyte count, we have not seen. We've seen some infections, but we haven't seen very significant serious infections. We've seen the platelets. There's a condition where platelets can be affected. The major side effects really are affecting the immune system. The thyroid is the commonest. We've seen the platelets, a very rare kidney condition. Those are immune conditions. We have seen some infections. For the most part, they've been manageable. The risk of serious infections is only slightly more than we saw with placebo patients.
Next question.
Can you develop MS at any age?
Yes. What? You can develop MS at any age. The commonest age is between, say, 20 and 45 or so. And MS is typically, as I said, more common in women than men, about 3 to 1. Over the age of 50, we often have more commonly may see progressive MS, and that's equal in men and women. But MS has been described in infants, and MS has been seen in people maybe in their 70s or 80s for the first time. Some of them may have had it before that for years in a mild form, but we can see it at any age. Although there is a common age group, it can be at any age.
One more question. If you've got, they're doing all this research on genos and going in and looking at your genes. With Dee's genes, could we have predicted by looking at her genes that she would have had MS at any time? I mean, is it something that you can predict in her set of genes?
Not yet. So one of the slides I showed you there was future directions, and it talked about looking for biomarkers, and that could be one of them, is looking at someone's genome or gene pattern and saying, we look at what genes you have, and based on this, you are going to be a responder to X drug or Y drug, or you're going to have a progressive type of MS. This is the hope going forward for the future. And so there are centers, I know there's a center in California, and certainly at the University of Miami, they have great genetic research that's going on. And they're getting thousands of samples of blood from people, especially when there's multiple family members, and trying to see the genome. The problem is with MS is it's not just one gene that's been shown to occur more frequently. There's over 100. So we're still trying to learn the pattern because there's so many genes that seem to be abnormal.
So one day they'll be able to predict it ahead of time.
I think in the future, yeah, we'll be able to consolidate that information and definitely get some information from that in the future. We don't have it yet.
Hi. As far as secondary progressive goes, my impression is that there are no indicated disease-modifying therapies available for it. And if that's the case, is there anything on the horizon? And also, I find that neurologists are really overrun, and it's hard to get a lot of time with one. And so when you move into a stage like that, when you're trying to and maybe this is for you, to develop a plan to be the best that you can be, where do you go for something like that? Because sitting with a neurologist, sometimes it's hard to put all that together. And for me, it can be hard to organize that.
Well, firstly, there is an approved disease-modifying drug for secondary progressive. That's novantrone or mitoxantrone. It's a chemotherapy drug, which has been around for about, I don't know, 15 years or something like that. But it's very toxic. So I think most neurologists now, I don't use it anymore. Do you? Have you used that lately? I've not used that for years because it's so toxic. It can cause leukemia and heart failure, so we don't generally use it. Secondly, yes, there are things that are pointed out. So firstly, this drug, ocrelizumab, is coming along, was studied for primary progressive MS. So we don't know where the FDA is going to situate this drug. Are they going to say it's for progressive forms of MS? Because many of us are starting to think progression is progression. Whatever way you got there, and it's progressive, and maybe it's going to respond to the same drug. So potentially, they will allow us to use it for secondary progressive types of MS too. That would make sense to me because we think progressive MS, mechanistically, progressive forms of MS are similar. So ocrelizumab could be an option. I also showed you about the information about biotin. And I'm not sure in your area you could find out. There's probably somebody around who's doing the biotin trial. So high-dose biotin is going to be something in the future. I showed you another study, two other studies that are using going with progressive MS, the siponimod. Siponimod is a drug that just published the preliminary results, was beneficial in secondary progressive MS. And I showed you also lecanemab, which is being studied in progressive MS. So yes, we have several studies now that potentially in the next couple of years will bear some fruit. And certainly right now, ocrelizumab, hopefully in the next few months, and biotin are two that are right there on the horizon. In terms of your office visit, that's very important. You say neurologists are overrun. And that's why that office visit thing that I showed you is so important. I've done that with Stuart before, where I've spent most of the whole program talking about it, because it's so important. Because if you come into your office and you put down the facts, tell us about your drugs, your questions, your symptoms, you put that down at the time of your visit, and the neurologist can look at that and assimilate that. There's no waste of time to establish the facts. You can spend the entire visit talking about what do we do about them instead of extracting them. The worst thing is for me to spend half of my visit extracting what are your drugs, what are your symptoms, what are your questions. If I spend half of the time extracting that, I don't have much time left. So put the things down. The worst symptom, you know, that is the door symptom. You've probably all had a door symptom. You know what the door symptom is? Some of you can imagine what a door symptom is. It's the symptom at the door. So you spend half an hour with the neurologist, or maybe 40 minutes. You spend some time. You get to the door and say, I forgot to ask you about this. Well, you definitely don't have time at the door after half an hour to talk about the bladder. My bladder is high frequency. I get up 5 times at night. You haven't got time. It needs to be down there so we can talk about these things. Very important.
This gentleman was not here at the beginning of the program, so he did not hear about the communication tool. So if you want to just refresh that with him, then.
I did hear that.
Okay.
It was the last slide.
Yeah.
You were here.
I did. And then there was the plan development, or when you move into secondary progressive, I mean, the new approach you have to take. How do you take a holistic approach to that? Are there services available to help somebody really kind of get a holistic plan down? Sorry, maybe that doesn't make sense.
So the most important thing about secondary progressive currently, because the only drug we have is novantrone, we're not going to give you. There are some people that I see who come down and see me. They've moved down from New York or somewhere else. They have secondary progressive or primary progressive. They're on one of these disease-modifying, relapsing, remitting drugs. And I say, well, you know, this medication has not been shown to work. There have been clinical trials. For example, Copaxone was tried for primary progressive MS. It failed. Gilenya was tried for primary progressive MS. It failed. And so people come down and they're on these drugs. And somebody says, well, this kind of pseudoscientific answer, it's better than nothing. Or if you take one arm of the study, it worked for some group of people. I don't use that science, and I'm going to advise those people and say to them, this drug, there's no scientific evidence this is working for you. I don't recommend it. That's generally what I would say. And in this situation, everything else I spoke about, the self-management, managing your symptoms the best we can, managing your bladder, which causes a lot of problems for people with MS, managing your walking, your gait safety, your risk of falling, managing all your other, your general health, your diet, and everything else, it becomes crucial in that situation. And that's what I would be doing.
Okay.
In the past, we've talked about damage to the nerve fiber itself.
And we've established that once the nerve fiber is severed, there is no reparation for it. If there's still a reflex in the muscle, would that suggest that the fiber has not been severed? Or will reflexes happen anyway?
No. There's different things that control a reflex. The control of reflex is a pathway that goes all the way from the brain through the spinal cord. Typically, in people with MS, we're often going to see very hyperactive reflexes. That's because there's two things controlling every muscle. There's something that makes a muscle move one way and something that makes it move the other way, and there's a balance between them that controls the movement and the reflexes. And if there's a lack of balance, then that's when you would see abnormal reflexes or abnormal strength, one group of muscles stronger than another. If a nerve is severed, then there is no function at all. You will not see anything move. But if one group of nerves is still present and another group has been more damaged, that's when you'll see changes in things like reflexes. So if all the nerves to a particular, if you cut a nerve completely to a particular muscle, nothing happens at all. But if some nerves are working, others are not, that's when you'll see changes like you're referring to.
I have two questions. My daughter was diagnosed with MS a year ago at 16. She has a hard time sleeping. Rather than sleeping pills, melatonin works for a while, and then she has to increase the amount of melatonin she's taken or swap and take Benadryl. Is there anything that you would suggest for that we could do to help her go to sleep at night?
I'll give you my suggestions. Okay. Sleep hygiene, I like to call it. Sometimes maybe a diary, I find this helps quite often. Having something to write down your thoughts on right before you go to bed, just kind of purging everything, because a lot of times that is what keeps people awake, because they'll lay there and think and think and think about things or think about what they need to get done. I have found in more patients than not, it helps to write down all the thoughts. You can throw it away, you can keep it, whatever you want to do with it, but as long as you get them out, sometimes you sleep a little better. There's other things like drinking caffeine, sugars, anything that you late at night, or how much takes anything for fatigue, making sure you don't take it too late. There's also other things that have been known to help with sleep, like soft music. Make sure that during the daytime she's not like in the bed. Make the bed the place for sleeping. Dark, quiet room. TV is not usually a good idea, but make that if she feels like she needs to get up and sit in a chair or sit somewhere other than the bed. And a lot of times that will help make that bed designated for sleeping. Those are my suggestions.
Turn off the iPad.
iPad. Put all of the TV, iPad, everything like that makes stimulation. And so it's got your brain going and going and going, and it makes it harder to calm down. So the iPad, just much like the TV.
Okay. My second question, my daughter is 17 years old. She is on Gilenia. And the concern, she's still, of course, way before childbearing age. And that is one of the more, aggressive MS medications. So what you said a few minutes ago about, you know, the lady that asked the question about breast cancer and, you know, you worry about some of them 10, 20 years down the road, that was my concern in the very beginning. I don't even know how to even word my question on this. I guess what's the better medication or what should be my concerns around Gilenia and my daughter taking it? I mean, in 10 years, do I have to worry about cancer with her? I mean, what are the concerns there? She's 17.
Yeah, so beta serum was introduced in 1993. It's 23 years and 3 months or something. We know a lot about long-term safety and long-term efficacy about beta serum and Copaxone. And we can say we have not seen any risk for malignancies or cancer with these medications. Gilenia has been on the market 6 years now. Go back to the clinical trials, it's a little older than that. We're gathering experience worldwide. There's about 150,000 people on the drug, or some number like that, 140,000. So we're gathering experience about it, but we don't have long-term experience. If you say to me what's going to happen in 20 years, I can't tell you. This drug is modifying the immune system, and it's modifying it long-term. There's no doubt that if a woman is in childbearing age, they must practice contraception. because these drugs, like Gilenya, have had reports of fetal harm and fetal malformations. So a woman in childbearing age must practice contraception. If they want to fall pregnant, if they're planning a pregnancy on Gilenya, they must stop it and wait at least a couple of months, 2 or 3 months, before they go ahead. Long term, 20 years down the road, could there be some risk? There could be. And these are things we have to face up to. We have not seen that so far. So far, we're not seeing any signals for malignancies like breast cancer. There are some cases of skin cancer reported, but that's common in general, in the general population too. But we have not seen risk, that I know of, no signals for breast cancer risk or other malignancies of that type so far. But it's early, you know, it's not, we don't have the long 10 to 20 year track record yet.
Two or three questions remain before the end, maybe four.
I'll see if I can make this quick. I've had MS for 40 years, and I've been coming to these talks for many years. And I just want to encourage all of you to keep coming, because 40 years, I'm hearing more and more and more and more. They are finding out more. But with MS, they're going to be looking for more and more and more. It's just a disease that it's different for each one of us. We have MS, but our symptoms are different. Do encourage you to come and listen, because they are finding things and they're going to continue to find things. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. We agree with that.
Can each of you give me an opinion about magnesium? Is it something we should be taking or thinking about?
Magnesium is good for you. I mean, there's no specific study. I mean, they've talked about magnesium for muscle cramps and muscle fatigue. And a lot of the homeopathic sites talk about magnesium. And I'm saying you can measure your level in your blood. I think there's no evidence whatsoever that I know of that you need to take more than the recommended daily allowance, which most people get. So you can check levels and see if you're deficient. But outside of that, if your level's normal, I don't know of any indication that you need to take more than the recommended daily allowance that I know of.
Okay, we got time for two more.
Yes, Amanda, I would love to send that Dr. Seuss poem to my support group. How can I get a copy of that?
Watch the video.
You can do it on the video.
Online
too. You can just Google it. It's online. Just Dr. Seuss MS poem, and it should pop up there for you. Yeah.
I've been on Tysabri for 4 years, excuse me, and recently I've moved to a secondary stage, and I'm considering moving to Lemtrada. I mean, I'm not sure, and I've spoken to my neurologist about it, and we've talked about it, but... I'm just curious what your opinion is. Where do you go from there?
I'll give you my opinion. And my opinion is that Tysabri is a drug that is approved for relapsing forms of MS. Lemtrada is a drug that's approved for relapsing forms of MS. If you go back to the history of Lemtrada, as it was known, alemtuzumab, it was known in those days as Campath. It was actually tried initially for secondary progressive MS, and it did not work. It was not beneficial. Tysabri, down the road, in the recent years, we thought, well, there were some preliminary studies that suggested it might work for secondary progressive MS. And so a clinical trial was undertaken with Tysabri for secondary progressive MS. It failed. It failed to meet its endpoint. It did not do the things in slowing progression that we hoped that it would do. So the answer to your question is both Lemtrada and Tysabri, unfortunately, are not medications that seem to have benefit for secondary progressive MS. Now, that said, there's a transition zone between relapsing MS and secondary progressive MS. And if somebody is transitioning to secondary progressive, but they still have some relapses, and they are in the early stages of secondary progressive, but still have relapses, and one drug is not working, whether it be Lemtrada or Tysabri, you could consider then the other one, as long as there is still a relapsing component to your disease.
Thank you. So, wait. There was another question. One more question. It's been waiting for, like, this point to ask. Somebody asked me what a nurse practitioner does or speaks with new patients coming in and the family coming in as well. How do you relate and how do you make them feel comfortable with all the new MS medications out there? But they asked about a nurse practitioner, not a neurologist.
Nurse practitioners are the same as neurologists.
They didn't ask about the neurologist.
A nurse practitioner that's trained is just as valuable and has the same knowledge as a neurologist. Maybe they're kinder because they seem to be more male neurologists and more female nurse practitioners. But outside of that, a nurse practitioner has pretty much the same knowledge. I don't think there's really any difference.
I'll tell you what I would look for in and for a nurse practitioner, because I've said it many times, MS certified, and the MS certification was almost as hard as my nurse practitioner boards. MS is a very complicated disease, so you want somebody who is, if you can, I know that all areas do not have that, but either an MS specialist neurologist, an MS specialist, an MS certified nurse practitioner, and they'll be more equipped to answer all of your questions about the disease modifying therapies. It's hard to keep up with, and that's great, though. I mean, there's 15 now, so I think I started when there were they were just starting the orals, so it's, and even since then, it's gone up. But if you have someone that's MS certified or someone that's very knowledgeable or stays up to date on MS, then they can hopefully navigate you through those risk benefits. And sometimes a nurse practitioner in some clinics are allowed to spend a little more time with you than the physician. So that's sometimes a benefit where you'll have a little more time. That's not like that everywhere, but some places it is. That answer the question?
I guess. Okay. Thank you. And Dr. Steingo, many people live with pain, and a lot of people are suffering from paroxysmal pains, and they want to know if this is a form of a relapse or if it's just pain that they have to learn to live with.
I mean, it could be both. So pain we know now is a common symptom of MS. And you remember in years gone by, they used to say pain doesn't happen with MS, but we know now it does. There's many different kinds of pains that can happen with MS. Spasms and spasticity is a form of pain. Electrical feelings, shooting feelings are common forms of pain. Trigeminal neuralgia, facial pain. So there are many different causes of pain in MS. And so if someone is pain-free and all of a sudden they develop pain at the onset of this symptom, that is a relapse. When this is a new symptom, someone has a new symptom of facial pain or trigeminal neuralgia, that would represent a relapse. But then subsequently that would, we would treat it, it would get better, it would be under control. And they may be prone to symptoms intermittently after that as a result of the first relapse. But each time it happens, it's not necessarily a relapse. It's what we call a paroxysmal symptom. It means it just comes and it goes because the original scar is still there.
Great. Thank you very much. Everybody say thank you.
All right. A couple of things real quick while Don's making his way up. One, we'd like to thank Teva Pharmaceuticals. They're the ones that provided the grant for this educational program. Let's give them a big round of applause, please. Thank you. And two, the evaluation forms that's on the tables, please make sure you fill those out before you leave. Those are what gives us the feedback that we need to continue to provide the type of educational programs that you want. Not that we want, but that you want and request. We build our programs around those. Now it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you one of my childhood team members, I would say, heroes. Don McNeal was a member of the 1978-79 National Championship teams for the University of Alabama. He's also a member of the Super Bowl 17 and 19 Miami Dolphins. He is a NFL Sports Hall of Fame member, as well as the Alabama Sports Hall of Fame. He is also one of our inaugural inductees into the Champions of MS. It gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Don McNeal.
Is everybody okay? I'm so glad to be here today. My brother-in-law, Jack Davis, he's been concerned, he and his wife been concerned about me all day long. You know why? I forgot to brush my teeth. I'm sorry. You know, that happens because I have MS. But I didn't forget to brush my teeth. Nobody need to avoid me, okay? But I'm so glad to be here.
Me? No,
I hate you, man. But I am so glad to be here today. I really and truly am. Yes, I have MS, and I tell you what, I call MS. Later I'll tell you what I call that, MS. But I'm so glad to be here. I really and truly am. Tell you a story. Start with a story. Apostle Paul, a lot of you guys may know who that is. One of the guys in the Bible. He saw this guy. This guy was saying, look, I want to go to heaven. I'm going to heaven. I know I'm going. Paul said, you might be going, but you know what? I want you to take a test. I want you to do something for me, okay? I want you to go to hell first. I want you to go to hell first and just check it out. Now, you might like it, but just go to hell first. He said, okay, I'll do that for you. So he pushed the elevator, and the guy went down, 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 and kept going down. He got down, and then the doors opened. The guy found himself in hell. He got out the elevator, and he saw this nice green grass. He saw all this nice golf course. And all that. He said, man, this is great. Then he run around the corner and saw this guy. This guy said, come on back down here later on. He said, I will. And then he got around the corner and he saw this person with this pitchfork and this red thing on his head. And he said, who are you? He said, I'm just a friend down here. Won't you come on back later on? He said, you know what? I think I will. I'm going to come back. So the guy went back to the elevator, pushed the floor to go back up. He went up and up and up and up and up and up. And he got to the top floor. The elevator opened up. And he said, he saw Paul, the guy that told him to go down to hell. He said, Paul said, okay, how did you like hell? He said, you know what, man? I've been hearing so many terrible things about hell. But you know what? I want to go back. He said, you want to go back to hell? Yes. I liked it. I saw some interesting people down there, and I saw this young girl that I like, and I want to go back and see her too. He said, okay, well, you know what? I'll make the reservation and I'll see you back to hell. So he put him back on the elevator, and the guy went down and down and down and down, and as he got a little closer to hell, he started smelling something that was stinky and all that. He went down and down, and he got there, and the door opened up, and he saw all this smoke, and everything was burned up, and it was terrible looking. He said, wow. He went around the corner. He saw this guy, and he told his guy and his wife, and they was working so hard doing all this terrible work. And then he went around the corner and he saw this guy in this red, had this pitchfork and had this red suit on and all that, and found out his name was Satan. He said, Satan, man, I was here the other day, a minute ago, and man, what happened? Satan said, today is reality. Yesterday was a dream, okay? Today is reality. Yesterday was a dream. You know what? I don't want to go to that place. I know a lot of you guys don't want to go either. It's no fun. It won't be any fun for me. But see, I had growing up, I had a father and a mother that taught me so many things. And like I say, this is one of my sisters here. Her name is Eula, and her husband Jack, and they're very, very important to me. But you know, when I was 6 years old, something happened very bad in my life. My mother died. My mother died of a massive brain hemorrhage. And guys, you know what? I was devastated to lose my mother like that. Can you imagine? 6 years old and I lost my mom. What am I going to do? But you know what? I am so glad that I had a father that loved the heck out of me. My father whipped my butt, but he loved me, you know, and I know that. But my father was a great person. Along with my father, I had six sisters and I had four other brothers. 10 of us, yes, it was a big family, but I needed all of them. And you know what? You guys, my sister, taught me how to be the person that I am today. So I appreciate my other five sisters and my four other brothers, and they helped me to be the person that I am today. And they helped me to handle this thing called MS. Because if I didn't have them, I wouldn't be able to handle it. But you know what? They have helped me to handle it, along with a lot of people. I think about when I was coming through elementary school, I had a third grade teacher. My third grade teacher, you know what her name was? Her name was Mrs. Biggs. She wasn't that big, but she was a tall lady, very skinny lady. She told me every day, I came to class, she said, Don, I want to teach you this poem. I said, Miss Biggs, I'm too cool. I don't want to learn your crazy poem. She said, Don, it's going to be very important that you learn this poem. I said, lady, you don't know nothing about me. I don't want to learn that crazy poem. She said, Don, it's going to be very important that you learn this poem. Each and every day, she would come to class, and she would recite this poem over and over again. You know what I did every day? I closed my ears because I didn't want to hear this stupid poem. But you know what happened at the end of the year? I learned that poem. And you know what? It's ironic. I can say that poem even today. And I've been out of school a long time. The poem went something like this. She said, Don McNeal, when your work has just begun, never leave it until it's done. Do your work, great or small, do it well or not at all. My third grade teacher taught me that, and that has become a saying in my life. Always do my best. No matter what happens in my life, always do your best. So Ms. Biggs taught me about that. And then I had the opportunity, like I said, I have six sisters and four other brothers that helped me so much, and I love those girls, my sisters and my brothers, so much. But I had the opportunity to play football in high school. Had the opportunity to play for this great football coach named Coach Latham. And you know, they have so many football coaches for everything. I have a football coach for defensive back, cornerbacks, and all that. So they have at least 15, 16 football coaches for everything. But you know how many coaches I had when I was coming up in high school? I had three coaches. You know what? Those coaches taught me how to do everything. And I'm so glad that I had those three coaches help me to do great and mighty things. Then I had an opportunity to go to, you guys may know, I think you do, one of the best college programs in the world. Had the opportunity to play for the University of Alabama. Roll Tide. You can say that, Roll Tide. But you know what? I want to stop and ask a question here. What's your favorite football team? Anybody have one? I come on now. I heard who? Okay, we got Alabama. We're gonna hold those. We're gonna hold that. Somebody said Auburn. Who said Auburn? War Eagle? Okay. I ask this question because see, I wanna know how many national championship Auburn ever won. Do you know? Huh? Aren't you a fan? Two? Okay, we'll give you two. But you know, I like you because you went to Auburn. They won three. I'm gonna give you this extra national championship. They won three, and I know that. Anybody else have another football team here that they like? Anybody else? Who? Somebody said who? LSU Tigers. How many nationals have they won? Do you know? I know because they hadn't won any. But you know what? I love LSU, man. I do. I love LSU. Yes, sir. They won one. They won one. We'll give them one. Okay. Okay. Anybody else? Who? Arkansas. I like Arkansas. How many nationals have they won? We won one. Okay. That's good. That's good. They up and coming. Okay. Now, I had the opportunity to play for the University of Alabama. You know how many national championships the University of Alabama ever won? Do you know? How many? How many? How many? Somebody said 16. And you know what? You're right. 16 national championships. And you know what? They're the defending national championship today. Matter of fact, they got a game. I'm going to try to get through. They got a game at 3:30. They're playing Mississippi State. We're going to beat them, okay? We're going to beat them, okay? But you know what? I had a great time playing in college. Had a great time playing in college. Then my life goes on. Had opportunity to play for the Miami Dolphins. Had opportunity to play there. Had a great time. Had opportunity to go to 2 Super Bowls. And had a great time doing that. Matter of fact, I went to Super Bowl 17 and I missed a tackle. And the guy went for the winning touchdown. Guess what, guys? I was devastated. I lost that particular game because I missed that stinking tackle. But you know what? I'm better because I missed that tackle. Because it helped me to be the person that I am today. Coach Bill Bryant, Coach Don Shula, and a lot of people saying, Don, we hate you, Mr. Tackle, but son, come on back. But see, I had the reporters and all those guys, they would say, Don McNeal, Coach Shula's going to cut you. Don McNeal, you are nothing. Don McNeal, what are you going to do now? But you know what? I found out that it's not all bad in missing a tackle. Because, see, I had somebody always was in my corner. My Lord and Savior was in my corner saying, Don, it's going to be okay. Yeah, you missed a tackle, but it's really going to be okay. Don't worry about it because, see, I'm in there with you. And so, guys, you know, like I said, I've had the opportunity to do a lot of great and mighty things in my life. But as you know, right now, I have this thing called, I have MS. I hate that. But you know what? But you know what I call MS? It's multiple sclerosis. Yes, it's multiple sclerosis. But you know what? I call MS my savior. Because, see, I can't handle it. But, see, he can. And, see, that's what it's all about. Him handling my disease for me. And that's what I decided to do, turn it over to him. He helps me to do that. I know a lot of you guys and ladies have MS, have this thing, but you know what? You can do anything. You can do anything except fail. If you have MS, you cannot fail. You cannot do that. You can make it, and you can do great and mighty things with this disease. That's what I've tried to do. And how did I contact MS? I was running in Detroit, Michigan, running in Detroit, Michigan with my brother. I'm running, having a great time running, and we're sitting there talking, and all of a sudden I fall down. Bam! I got up, I said, my brother's gonna think I'm a clumsy idiot. But I got up and just started running again, and all of a sudden I fell again. Oh, man. So I got up the next time and I started running again, and all of a sudden I fell again. Bam, fell on my behind. I decided to get up and go home, back to Miami, Florida, and go to a doctor. So I went to a doctor, and guys, it took so long to diagnose me. I think it took about a half year for them people to diagnose me and tell me that I had this disease called MS. And you know what? I had the disease called MS, and it hurt my heart. I cried a lot. I called my sisters and my brothers, and I didn't know what I was going to do. And they told me, Don, hey, give it to God. He helped you handle it. And that's what I did. So, guys, if you got MS, anything else, you can handle it. You got to give it to God. And you know what? If you do that, everything is going to be okay. It's going to be okay. You know, it's okay in my life. I have MS. But you know what? I've given it to God, and He works it all out for me. He really do. So, listen, I'm so glad to have been here today. Hopefully, I've said things so maybe to encourage you to go on and be the best that you possibly can be. Okay? Now, anybody got any questions about anything? National Championship, MS, anything? Anybody have any questions?
Anybody have a question for Don?
Yes.
All right, one moment, please.
Does anyone in your family have MS?
No one in my family have MS. No, we don't. I don't know where it come from and stuff like that. So I have it, and I'm showing my friends and my family how to handle the situation. And so, you know, no, we don't. No, nobody in my family have MS.
Good.
Yeah. And then this is good.
Really. Oh, here, Don.
Yes.
What was that poem you learned in third grade?
My what now?
The poem you learned.
The poem. Okay. Well, I tell you what, I see you after I get through, and I tell you again, okay? I love to do that, okay? I love to do that.
And by the way, you can watch it on the video recording after we publish the video recording, okay?
Get it from me, because you can't hear it off of there. Okay. Anybody else? Yes.
What would be your advice if you're helping somebody that has MS in your family?
I need the last part.
Your advice if you're trying to assist someone with MS?
Mm-hmm. Or just be a support system. Be there and tell them, hey, it's going to be okay. I have MS. You know what? It's not that bad because I have it and I'm handling it. You know what? You can handle it because I know who you are. So just encourage the person. Let them know they're going to be okay. Okay? Anyone else? I'm not going to push this down.
Yeah, right.
I know you said that.
Sure.
Yeah,
sure. There's a question over there.
Yes, sir.
With all the concussion issues
that
are going around the NFL right now,
yes.
Do you think that had anything to do with your MS?
I really don't know.
Yeah.
I really don't know. But it might have. We're going to check it out. And matter of fact, we're going to check that out. Okay? It's already being checked out, okay?
One more question over here.
Well, I wish I could. Yes.
Yes. How long have you had MS?
I've had MS since 2001. 2001. So that's a long time. I really, really is. Yes. Okay. Lady Green. I like in green.
Thank you. I'm an AK.
Okay.
Oh, he's got hold of this. This is Shirley Nelson, and I found out that in 2007, that I found out my cognitive skills were not, in other words, my elevated and go up as high as it should have. Uh-huh. I worked for the school system and everything. Okay. And my sister was a minister and all, so she was my support person.
Okay.
So we went to Dr. Isaac Shake. I'm going to name it.
Isaac Shake.
And he gave me an open MRI.
Okay.
And found I had 8 mini strokes.
Oh, well.
I had no earthly idea what was going on. And then 3 years later, I had 3 more. Mm. So I can kind of identify with what you're saying here about the relapsing, all that, because I've gone through it. Well, a lot of young ladies and young men, they said, well, what about the vision? I almost lost my vision. But I went to the eye doctor, I'm not going to call him Dr. McDuff, I'll just tell you.
Okay.
He did what you call an eye implant.
He actually
took my eye out, the right one.
Uh-huh,
okay. Because I'm just going to be quickly. And then he was able to get all that information out.
Okay.
Cataracts. Okay. And now I don't hardly need glasses.
You
I see the doctor
fine, right?
once a year.
Good.
So anyway, I was just 46, 48. I'm 71 now, y'all. Just had a birthday. So look how the Lord has kept me. Although my sister's gone on to heaven, I'm still here.
All right.
Praise God.
Glad
so
here.
The whole thing is, you mentioned your belief. That is my belief. I do mission work.
Okay.
And then I do volunteer work. And I let people know. But the people in my community is not well informed. They don't know what's going on. They don't want to accept it.
Right.
So this is what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to learn as much about what's going on so I can introduce it to my community.
Right.
I would be the first one to do that if possible.
That's good. That's
thank
all
you very
people.
Much.
And
thank
our
you.
Community.
Thank you.
And our community.
Thank you.
And we're trying to educate those people about that.
Anybody
so,
else have a question?
I know that. Anybody? Yes.
Another question over here.
You played for some amazing coaches.
Yes, I did. I had an opportunity to play for Coach Bear Bryant, Coach Don Shula. It's great.
I mean,
man right there said I played, but I ain't played. But yeah, I've been fortunate and I've been blessed.
Which is an amazing blessing.
Yes,
so,
it is.
Is there a group? Is there a coach that had the biggest impression on you in your life, or was it a high school coach, college coach, or you know?
The coach that had the best impression
biggest
on
impact,
me.
Biggest
okay.
impact.
The person that had the best impact on me, not a coach.
Bill Oliver.
Was my father. You know why? Because I know my father loved me. Can you imagine losing your wife, and she was 40 years old, and he had to raise 10 kids by himself? No. I can't imagine it. I have one daughter, and it's tough raising her with my wife.
Yeah.
You know what? Mr. Henry McNeal, that's my father's name. He's my role model, and he's my coach. And he did a great job with me, with us. And that's who it is, my father.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Great answer.
Thank you.
Over here, Don.
Well, as an athlete, I'm quite sure conditioning is something that's probably important to you. Is there any advice or recommendations that you may have as far as the exercise or routine for patients with MS?
Well, just do the things that come natural, like jumping jacks, and when I go to the gym, I do lunges and I do I run a lot, ride my bicycle every day and all that. So things like that. Just get a good sweat going and sweat a lot and just give it to God and God will work it all out.
Works for him is not necessarily might work for you, all right? So don't everybody just get around and start doing jumping jacks, all right?
Brother, do your jumping jacks, okay? Anyone else? Yes. You're the lady.
Yeah, Don has a book out. I'm sure he has it. I read the book. It's the most inspiring book I've read, especially raising 10 children, as he said, without the mother. It's a fantastic book. Get it and read it.
Good. I have the book here now. I have the book here now, and it's outside, and we get you that book right
so
now.
So I read that book, too, and I get to joke around with his sisters and beat and bust on him all the time about that.
He don't know.
All right.
Anyone else?
If anybody else, then we're all finished here for today, and we want to thank Don for coming in.
Okay, well, I'm outside. I'll sign your autograph and
all
that
right.
stuff.
Don's going to be outside for anybody that wants a photograph with him. Then he's going to sit there, and he's going to pose for you, okay? So thank you, Don.
Thank you.
Yeah, gotcha. I even learned that handshake. Isn't that amazing? There you go. All right, so everybody, thank you for coming down here today. And again, we have to thank Dr. Brian Steingo for coming in from Florida, and Amanda Adcock for coming down from Coleman, Alabama. All right, and we've got to thank them graciously. We have seminar evaluations that you're all given. We need you to please fill that out. Give it to this lady who's wearing a red. She thought it was crimson red, but she's wearing a red just to be here for today's game. All right, and that's Jill in the back. If you could give her your evaluations, please. I want to thank Ken for helping out with today's program. And I got to thank you, all of you, for coming down here and being here for this program today. So thank you. Drive carefully on your way home. And we hope to see you again. Bye-bye.